Everybody, welcome, and thanks for sticking around. My name is Alan Light, and I am thrilled and so honored to be a part of this event tonight. We'll do these intros really quick because Ken sort of told you who everybody is here, and we want to get as much talking from us and then questions from you as we can through the rest of the night. You have already heard from Ken Burns, a man who has transformed the possibilities of documentary film and changed the way we think about so many things in American history. Joining us also tonight, producer Julie Dunfey and writer and producer Dayton Duncan, longtime associates of Ken's who worked on this country music project, and a man who you just saw in multiple haircuts on the screen in front of you. Country Music Hall of Famer, 21-time Grammy winner, Mr. Vince Gill. So I guess I'm going to start as kind of as broad stroke as there is to start up here and start with Ken just to say we know the kinds of subjects that you have tackled in some of these previous projects, the Civil War, baseball, Vietnam. What was it that made you think that country music was something to take on and the scale that you take things on? And was that something that immediately connected for you or something that it kind of took time to figure out?
We are storytellers and we're interested in good stories. And when the idea was presented by a friend 8.5 years ago about country music, it just, all the bells went off inside me. And I said yes, and I raced back from Texas to New Hampshire and went to Dayton and said, country music, and he said yes. We knew it would be a complicated, almost Russian novel of a story over a century, many generations, a complicated family with primary and secondary and tertiary characters. You know, how emotional it was, I don't think we were prepared for it. We didn't know that we would have the kinds of moments that Dwight had with holding things together by Merle Haggard or Go Rest High on That Mountain by Vince and many other moments. But it was, from the beginning, it seemed completely consistent. And I think the biggest thing is that country music has been categorized by commerce and convenience into this one thing, where it has never been a one thing. It's always been a many thing. And like everything in American music, it's always a mixture of things and not a one thing. And so we chart that. And at the same time, you realize that what Harlan Howard says in the introduction, that it's three chords and the truth, is really true. It doesn't have the complexity and the intricateness of some forms of classical music and jazz, but it does have the truth, and it's speaking universal human truths that we all experience about love and loss, and that's what drew us to it.
So that, those layers, that depth, that's what you then spend 8 years sorting out. When you said you heard country music as an idea and said yes, what was that flash? What was it that you thought you were signing up for?
I think it's exactly what, I mean, I don't think we were prepared for the amount of emotion, but we were signing up for a complex generational story that we knew we had to tell.
I think we were signing up for yet another lens to look at the American experience. You know, I tell people I've been through the 1930s twice now, first with the national parks, then with the Dust Bowl, and I get to go through it yet again with Bob Wills, the Maddox Brothers and Rose, and it's another way, a very emotional way of understanding the American experience.
So for, I guess, both of you to answer, depending on how you look at the workflow here, but I assume that in the writing role and in the producing role, a lot of that is sort of wrestling this beast down into the story that you're going to tell. What was that for you to start from, at least this sort of crystal of an idea, and figure out where do we start this thing? Where are we going to stop this thing? How do we make this into a shape that even at, you know, even at 16 hours is a finite thing with a beginning and middle and end.
I had hair when we started. you know, the hardest thing for us on any project is the entry point, not only in the film but in each scene. How do you enter in and on a chronological storytelling way, and then on a series like this, if you're doing a biography, you end with the death and the legacy. And this is a different thing. Let me start at the back end of that, which is because we deal with history and not journalism, we need about a generation's arm's length away from the topic so that we can do historical judgment, if you will. It couldn't just be what is the most popular now. We don't know if that's going to be 20 years from now, the things that people will look back on and say, oh yeah, it was that song, it was that artist, it was that moment that was important. So we end our film around 1996, which is the death of Bill Monroe, Garth Brooks' skyrocket of fame, and Johnny Cash is a major figure in our film, who had been given up, dropped by his label, given up as a has-been, had just then gone back into a studio with a hip-hop producer, I might add, to sing some songs, just him and his guitar and his extraordinary voice, and revived and redeemed his career and his standing. So that's where we stop. We start in 1923 because that's the moment when this music that had heretofore been sung in fields and on porches and parlors and churches and things like that was recorded for the first time and was now being broadcast on the brand new medium of radio. And so it was now spreading. And so that's where we start with our narrative story. We backtrack to talk about the roots. Everything else is, I'm just an old reporter, you know. You go and talk to everybody you can. Vince kindly gave us a couple of hours one day in Nashville at the start, and we bounced ideas off him. He gave us good advice, as we did with many other people. You read everything you can, you listen to everything you can, and then I, as the writer, have to start. We did most of the interviews before I start writing, and then you just try to piece it together. You know, it's sort of like writing a country song, only instead of 3 minutes, it's 16 and a half hours long. And it's a string of stories, a string of songs. The one thing I did not want it to be, that the reason I lost so much hair, was because I didn't want it to be just a parade of celebrity names, and I really didn't want it to be a KTEL commercial in which there'd be this list of songs that you'd hear, you know, 3 seconds of. We wanted to pick songs and stories that could stand for all the songs and stories that we couldn't tell.
Julie, for you, what's not in the writer chair, but producing again, just the wrestling of all of this stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, we start right away collecting photographs, moving images, and as Dayton was saying, we do the interviews before he writes a script. So it's kind of this crazy process where we're doing everything at once. You know, we have a sense of what some of the stories might be, so we can be out there collecting, you know, pictures of Nashville in every single decade, or you know, whatever cities we think might be involved. And but we never stop collecting, we never stop researching. We do let the story come to us. We don't go in with a preconceived notion of what we think this story is, and then just execute it and deliver it to you. We're trying to discover every step of the way, and a lot of that happens in the interviews, which do come first. And then we hope we're sharing what we've discovered, but right up until we're locking the film, we're still looking for that picture that might tell the story a little bit better or whatever, and we're always looking, we're always trying to learn what the story is.
Vince, you're known as somebody who's paid attention to the history of this community, this universe that we're talking about. What, dumb question, but what is it that you feel like you've learned, or how have How has this project connected the dots differently for you? And why do you think it's important for the form? Why do you think it's important for country music to get looked at this way?
Well, I think in their hands, first and foremost, what I've taken away from this, you know, I've watched it over and over and over. It's very emotional for me to watch it because it depicts our entire history. And what's beautiful about the way it's been depicted is that it's finally got the respect that it's never had. You know, and as someone that's kind of given their life to it, to finally see our story told with that is it's amazing, you know, because they weren't insiders, but they weren't. They weren't part of the culture, they weren't part of the fiber, they weren't part of the history. But they told it in such a profound and honest way that it's light years more compelling than if we could have told it ourselves. You know, I think we would have lied. You know?
But stay with that for a second, and I'm curious for you guys. I mean, inevitably this stuff gets hidden behind so much mythology. These stories, you know, they get set in amber, they get told certain ways. We know, yeah, this is the thing that gets you to hear. What do you see that took to sort of get past that? What do you see sort of, you know, breaking through that here?
Well, I think once again, people's perception of country music. I mean, even in our own community of Nashville, we were looked down upon. You know, and even in the film, it talks about the Dust Bowl area. Those are my people, the Okies, and the people that were disparaged against and slandered and all those things. And just to finally, I can't find any other word that makes the most sense to me other than grateful. You know, I think that we as a community of musicians, I'll tell you one thing that I think is probably the most profound part of the whole thing is, you know, with our music and with our audience base and all that thing, you know, they think we're rednecks, they think we're hillbillies, they think we're all those things, and to some degree we are. But with that, I think they would assume that socially maybe we were similar in the way that the country was with our race relations and things like that. And when you tell this history and you find out how beautifully we have intertwined all of that kind of relation, you know, it was a black man that helped A.P. Carter find all those songs. It was a black man that taught Hank Williams how to play the guitar. It was, you know, we never had that issue. We never had that problem. And to see that really be kind of in my mind, it's the foremost thing that you come away from that maybe, hey, that's not how I perceived that to be. And I think as someone who does see all of us as equals and all of us, you know, in the way that I know how they feel. And so for us to have this light shone on us and to have people say, hey, they didn't care where it came from, black or white or Hispanic or in any way, shape, or form, the community, the music people never, ever cared. So that to me is like maybe the high point of it for me, in that it, in truth and in detail, it says how I've always felt, and it's honest.
I think one of the things that helped break through mythology when we were talking to people, most of our films we have historians and experts helping tell the story, helping the narrator, and we do have one in this film. We didn't know we would only have one, but when we started talking to people like Vince, Roseanne, Cash, Merle Haggard, Willie Nelson, what we found out is they knew their history really, really well. And so when we went to interview Merle Haggard, we started asking, Dayton started by asking questions about Jimmy Rogers and the Maddox Brothers and Rhodes, because he knew that Merle was interested in those folks, and he really opened up and could convey that history to us. And then when we got to his story, I think he was much more open, because we had started at that point with his knowledge of the history, and the history they gave us was intimate in a way that maybe from an expert it wouldn't be.
This is maybe too multi-part a question, so can attack it how you will, but really interesting to think about this project in relation to two of the previous projects, which is to say, you know, the jazz series on one hand and the Civil War series on the other hand. The relationship that, you know, the relationship of this universe to that history in the American South, the relationship of this music history to that other, in some ways, you know, very parallel through time history of jazz. How did that, you know, how do these things interconnect for you? Did you, you know, did they relate in your mind to, you know, what you had done in those worlds? Again, take a piece of that or all of it, depending if that's too much.
No, I don't think it's too much. This is the film that's most similar to country music is jazz, because the subject is music, and music, which for filmmakers is traditionally a background music, has to be a priori a background, a middle ground, a foreground, and a kind of hyper ground as you dissect and really dematerialize and rematerialize music. And so they're very similar in lots of ways. But they're also very similar because this is an American story. And we keep thinking, as Vince has alluded to, that this is just a bunch of redneck hillbillies. And if we can do that, then we can safely put country music over here, and we can imprison it in the conventional wisdom, the superficial knowledge of that. And it's completely connected to everything else. Willie Nelson phrases like a jazz man. Chet Atkins plays like Django Reinhardt. These are interconnected forms. There are no borders. You don't need to have visas. You don't have to have immigration policies to get from one to the other. These are not separate silos. They're completely connected to one another. It's a complex molecule, and country music is an atom that attaches to the blues, that attaches to jazz, that attaches to R&B, that attaches to country, to pop, to rock, of which it is one of its parents, along with rhythm and blues, and even to classical music. And so this is all American music, and as I said before, it's all a mixture. And so it goes back. Our first episode is called The Rub. And The Rub is Ketch Secor's phrase to mean the friction created in the American South by the intersection of black and white, by, you could say symbolically, the fiddle and the banjo. The banjo from Africa, the fiddle from Europe and the British Isles. And for most of the history of this country, that friction has produced indignities. And country music is not immune to those indignities. But in this case, the net is a positive one, in that that friction is the creative friction that created country music, created the blues, created jazz, created the rhythm and blues, and all these other forms. At the heart of the American story, and Julie correctly rescued me, is this idea embodied in the second sentence of the Declaration, that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. The guy who wrote that sentence owned more than 200 human beings. He didn't see the hypocrisy or the contradiction, and he didn't see fit to free any of those people and set in motion an American narrative that is in every subject that we've undertaken, with almost one or two exceptions, is dealing with this. The worst case of this is the Civil War. We murdered 750,000 of our own people. Huge, staggering amount of human beings at a country that had 30 million population over the question of slavery, in a country that had 45 years proclaimed that all men were created equal. This is revolving in everything we do. And how wonderful, therefore, it is to find in the people, as the New York Times today said, that we still feel comfortable legitimately discriminating against, right? Rednecks, right? At least we can feel really good about discriminating about against rednecks. You cannot. You are presupposing that somebody doesn't feel that when Hank Williams wrote, "Hear that lonesome whippoorwill, he sounds too blue to fly, the midnight train is whining low, I'm so lonesome I can cry," that he meant it for everybody except for these unfeeling boors. Well, in fact, it's those unfeeling boors who wrote that song. And that it's really important, particularly for all of us in this room, in this town, to understand that we have, as I said before, there's no them. There's just us. And the story that we've tried to tell in all our films is between the plural pronoun us and the bigger US. This is the similarities, the warp and the woof of all of the films are constant. And we are committed to telling this complicated story. And it is, the only thing we can say is that it is complicated and that it has undertow. There's something that Winton said to us in jazz. He said, sometimes a thing and the opposite of a thing are true at the same time. And we found that to be true in almost every story we've undertaken, and no more true than in this one, which seems to have the convenience, the kind of, whew, of the superficiality, the sort of juvenile nature of country music that turns out to be so profoundly human, so directly human, that it woke us up and rearranged our molecules doing it in a way very few films we've worked on ever have.
Dayton, so you may applaud that. Again, as the guy sort of tasked with taking these massive sorts of ideas and big swaths of history and turning them into something concrete, that idea of holding these conflicting ideas in your head, of being able to pull a narrative through that addresses these contradictions but also unearths some of these things that are not immediately evident. Other than, yeah, that's what takes 8 years to do. What, you know, what is
hair.
It? To, what is it to translate? I mean, what is it to translate those ideas into something we can turn on at home and watch?
Well, the important thing for me always, and Ken and Julie and I have worked together on many projects, and Ken and I, for a long time, our friendship was based on our belief in the Declaration of Independence and storytelling. Before we started working together, I was writing books. He was making his early films. So for me, and as a former reporter, I just need to study it and to talk to people, and then try to say, well, what is the story here? And in a project this large, then what are the stories here? And start trying to put them together in a way that, number one, makes sense, that you know, beginning, middle, end for a story, time for another story, how does that fit to the other thing? So it's more, it's weaving, actually, and to try to make an episode, a story that happens in episode one, if it's working well, might have a radioactive half-life. That's a bad weaving, isn't it? A bad metaphor, but that would reverberate in the third episode, and then again in the fifth, and so it's trying to put things together. And I write something that is twice as long, generally, as I know will be in the film. Bring it to our studio, Ken and Julie and an incredible group of editors and other people. Now it's everybody's. And we just start working it. And a lot of stuff has to go out. But I want everybody to start that process with knowing the things that we're discarding now, we could have saved, but we meant discarding something else. So I don't know if that answers it, but it's just, I believe in this process that we've followed now for that I've followed with Ken for about 30 years, which is you bring it together and everybody is working without ego of, well, I've already done this and you can't cut that, or you can't, editors won't let you change something, or that's the wrong music cue, or that's the wrong photograph. We all are dedicated to one thing only. How do we tell this story the best way we can? You know, obviously it needs to be accurate, it needs to be clear, but also how can it just be storytelling that is compelling? And both Ken and I, and Julie to a certain extent, I'm the weepiest of the three of us, so I'm drawn like Vince. All I ever wanted to do was to write something that, or to read something that moved me. And so that's
you know, what that line that you just saw in that scene from Vince is the key to the whole film. All I've ever wanted out of music is to be moved. I mean, that's it. All Tolstoy said that art is the transfer of emotion from one person to another. This is what the business we're in is that kind of emotional archaeology.
Can I add one more thing? From the start of this, we all took this, as we say, this is a story of a uniquely American art form, and it's uniquely American, and we very seriously believe in it as an art form. And art is created by artists. And so we wanted to tell the story of those artists, but it wasn't for the sake of just telling their story that we were telling it. It was to get to the art. And so we like to have stories about how us. I was fascinated by talking to people, and Ken as well, and Julie, about what goes into a song. How did that, where did that come from? And we also enjoy having people talk about the brilliance of a song, what makes that an enduring and great song. So it's in order to get to that point to talk about the art. And the remarkable thing about country music is its proof of so many of the great artists like Dolly and Loretta and others, Merle, came from the most, sometimes almost desperate poverty, but from the, you know, from a place that would be easy to overlook, that this is not soil that will grow great artists, and boy, is that ever wrong. Yeah. You know, these people are artists of the highest level. If you can write a song, a 3-minute song, with a match of poetry and a melody that becomes this direct delivery system into your heart, you've done something, and that is art.
And I think that the thing is that when you surround that with story, you've done something else. So everyone here has probably heard Whitney Houston's version of I Will Always Love You, which is just a phenomenal pop thing that traveled about as far as a pop song can go. But once you know how and why Dolly wrote it, all of a sudden her version has a kind of equality, a parody, even excels Whitney without taking anything away from Whitney Houston's endurable thing. Once you've understood the cri de coeur that was and is that song, this declaration of independence for Dolly, you will never forget that. And that's the thing about stories. We couldn't be K-Tel, we couldn't be the phone book. We had to tell stories, which means we couldn't tell everything, but the things that we did tell had to be enveloped and surrounded and loved by story. And that's, I said it before, the most important thing about this is that it is about love and loss. And it's 2 4-letter words we'd rather not discuss, and so we make country music all about good old boys and pickup trucks and hound dogs and 6 packs of beer, because no one wants to talk about, you know, the silence of a falling star lights up a purple sky, and as I wonder where you are, I'm so lonesome I could cry.
So you want to, let's put that in practice for a second. Vince, you want to sing us a song, and you want to tell us where it came from?
I'm the best you could get for free on a Monday. Thank you. No, they're right. You know, the thing that makes this music interesting is the stories behind them. There was a record made by Ray Charles that I think was probably one of the most pivotal records in the history of country music. In the early 60s, he made a record of all the great country songs, and Ray Charles was on top of the world. He was the biggest artist going, and he told his people that he, record company and managers and everything, that he wanted to make a country record. This was in the early 60s, and relations and race were pretty bad. And they said, Ray, that's suicide. There's no way you can make a country record. Why would you make a country record? And he so simply stated, I love the stories. And he was right. And he gave a credibility to our music, not unlike what these folks on this stage have done, given us a credibility that we may have never had and may have never garnered. And it doesn't go unnoticed. And watching Dwight talk about Haggard was so emotional, you know. And this is a song that I wrote for Merle on the morning of his passing. He was my very favorite artist of all time. It's called A World Without Haggard. I was on the road in Georgia when I heard Merle had passed away. Hell, I thought he'd live forever. He shaped every note I played. Tonight these old white lines look different than they usually do. He was my greatest inspiration, the reason why I sing the blues. He taught me how to play the guitar and write a country song. He spent time in San Quentin for the things that he'd done wrong. He made me proud to be an Okie. God knows we paid our dues. Was my greatest inspiration, the reason why I sing the blues. Oh, I'm lost in a world without Haggard. Oh, tell the truth to you and me. Oh, I'm lost in a world without Haggard. It's a world I thought I would never see. He gave his life to country music, and he's the best that's ever been. An honest voice of reason like we won't see again. If I could hear one last song, it's Merle that I would choose. He was my greatest inspiration, the reason why I sang the blues. He was my greatest inspiration, the reason why I sang the blues. Thank you. Thank you very much. And that's, thank you.
That's without you even, that's without you even pretending to leave the stage or anything.
No, hell, I'm going to join the Y here. Like
it's just while you're sitting there. So we've got, I know, a few more minutes for us, and then we're going to, at some point, I get the questions from you guys. Ken, what, you know, the said there are these central figures to this story. There's Haggard, and there's Hank, and there's Cash, and there's Dolly. And as fans, we know the contours of those stories. I mean, books have been written, movies have been made about all of those kinds of figures. What's big or small surprised you the most telling this story?
Well, I think I was continually surprised. I didn't know as much about country music as Dayton did, and so to me, everything I did know was so almost instantaneously superficially disqualified, or disqualified because of its superficiality. So to me, the supposedly familiar stories weren't. And, you know, just take John Cash for a second. We focus our attention on the love affair of him and June, which is important and a huge part of our film, and very little attention is paid to his first marriage to Vivian Libretto and the children he produced, including Roseanne. And Vivian has equals, if not more, screen time in this film than June does. I mean, not in relation to Johnny. She's got a whole backstory that is there for us before she meets and falls in love with Johnny Cash and vice versa. And I feel proud about that, that there's dimension to it, and that this is a family story. And sometimes what we tend to do with things that we think we know about is to just, as you said before, tell and retell. You know, we made a film on Jackie Robinson, and everybody tells the story, and I did too, in our baseball series, of Pee Wee Reese coming up and putting his arm around him as if, you know, white people needed to have skin even in that game. And it never happened. And a deeper dive in a separate film about Jackie Robinson revealed that we could have easily pushed a couple of more inches and found out that it hadn't happened. We wanted it to happen. We wanted to feel that we were good, but it didn't happen that way. And I think that as we've matured as filmmakers, I hope that we increasingly welcome and tolerate the complication and the undertow that's present in all these stories, and figure out ways to do it. Filmmakers notoriously, when something's working, it's like, don't touch it. It's fine. But if you adopt a process, as Julie and Dayton have described, where we are never stop researching, we never stop writing, and we often film before we've got anything written down, so that every time you see a talking head, it's a kind of happy accident of location, that we have to be corrigible to the end and willing to take even the best scene and open it up and destabilize it potentially in order to tell the more complex and complicating aspect of it. And we revel in it. We now have a neon sign in the editing room that says, it's complicated. and it just is a way to just remind us, you know, it's whatever you think is working today, don't leave it. Tomorrow it may not be working as well.
So maybe a parallel question to that, I guess, to Julie. Finding a visual style, finding a visual identity or signature for a series like this, you said 100,000 photos or whatever the number was. And of course, we all have in our head certain things about the ways that Ken Burns films look. How do you go figure out what, you know, what the look and feel and touch of this thing is going to be?
Well, I think you'll find it looks like a Ken Burns film. There are there's a lot of archival footage. I mean, we had the benefit of there were a lot of TV shows that came out in the 50s, 60s, and 70s, so we could find performances there. We do a lot of shoe leather, looking for archival photographs. We have one person dedicated exclusively to going back to our interviewees, going out to you know, people we haven't interviewed, but we're telling their story because they're no longer with us, going to their descendants and finding old photographs, finding family photographs. I mean, she goes around and people pull out, you know, shoe boxes from under the bed, trash bags full of things, and she sits at their kitchen table. And that's her job for a couple of years, is to find those photos, whether they're family photos. You know, another researcher, she's looking at institutions. And in the case of Jimmy Rogers, for instance, she was down at some bank in a little town in Texas that the family brought her into. And she found some photos, but she said, what's in that box up on that shelf? And they brought it down. And she found two photos of Jimmy Rogers that the family hadn't seen in 50 years. And now, that's great, as long as it serves the story. I mean, we don't just put them in because they're rare and never before seen, but when you find something like that that serves the story, that's gold for us.
And I would add, besides the visual style, is that one thing that's a little different for this film from the others is because we always have music as an important part of all the films that we make. We record and collect music before our talented teams of editors start to work on it, so they can be drawing from it from the beginning and sometimes editing directly to the music. But with the exception of jazz, this is the only one that we've done that the topic is music. So it's not, as Ken said, it's not just background, it's middle ground, foreground, and hyperground. And unlike jazz, jazz does have a lot of music that is lyric driven, but not nearly as much as country music. So we have the topic of our story are these songs. This is all about the songs and the stories behind them that get deeper and deeper and deeper. But the songs are telling something. And so my other nightmare would be you're walking into it, you're getting into an elevator with, you know, carrying on a conversation with somebody while someone is standing next to you with a banjo is singing a song, right? And actually it's the banjo song that's really more important than your conversation. That's very hard for a writer to get around a little bit, who likes to write a lot. But our editors, one of them is here, who edited our seventh and our third episode. Craig, raise your hand up there. But they found a way. They found very different way, you know, various different ways in which you could get a song established and hear a little breathing space for it to establish and then die down while the talkative narrator is reading or someone interviewee is speaking, and then give space for it again. And sometimes, as you saw in the thing with Dwight Yoakam, is talking about and singing a song, and you can sort of hear Merle in the background, and then Merle comes to the foreground. And we look at these different things when a new film brings a different challenge to us. We like that. Then don't consider it a challenge. We think of it as an exciting opportunity. And our editors did an astonishing job on this.
And may I do a shout out, Katie Haas, who's an associate producer and who did the shoe leather on archival footage. After 2 years search, she found a print of the only footage of Jimmy Rogers in a, you know, warehouse in Long Island. So she's in the audience tonight too. So.
I want to ask one last thing of Vince, and then I'll go to some of the questions from you guys. And this, I guess, sort of follows even from the song that you played, there's something that is so different, so unique about country music's relationship to its tradition, to its own tradition, that's different than other musics, that's different than other styles, I think. To write that song, to go back to Haggard, but the constant, are you sure Hank done it that way? Are you sure that it's always this looking back to, again, as the story goes, this sort of constant struggle of what's country music, what's real country music, you know, what stays in the title, what stays in the name, what stays in the genre. How do you think about that? How do you think about that, the way that gets passed, and the very sort of tangible and foregrounded way that gets passed?
Well, I think you have to learn your history. You can't just know it. You know, it might take me, I mean, in my case, because my family loved music and we played a lot of records, I knew who Jimmy Rogers was. I knew who the Carter family was and Roy Acuff. I didn't have to discover them from loving Merle Haggard. Go, okay, I love Merle Haggard. Who did he love? And then there's Lefty Frizzell, and then there's Bob Wills, and then that's what I mean by you learn your history. But I think it's also most important to me. I don't say that anybody else has to feel this way, but I have a deep reverence and a deep, deep, deep love and respect for those that came before me. You know, I mean, we had a great run in our run, you know, of a lot of success, but I don't like it more than the era that was really my cutting my teeth of learning, you know, when I was a little kid and I learned about Buck Owens and Merle Haggard and Bob Wills and all these people that I revered, you know, I still hold them here, and I'm still the kid. I'm 62, but you know, they're running out, you know, little by little, but they're still my mentors, you know, and as long as you have your perspective of respect, you know, for those that came before you. I mean, I'm out at the Opry all the time, and I leave my dressing room door open because Roy Acuff did. And they watch that, and they understand that, and I think it's a healthy respect. And the music has, you'll see in the film, it just, you know, it just goes in circles and circles and circles. It's always changed, and it's always been different, you know. And that's never going to change. You know, it's different now than it was 20 years ago and 20 years prior to that and all that. But, you know, it should not have to stay the same. It shouldn't have to just be one way. I've got a friend that's a comedian. He says, my granddad says that, you know, we all shouldn't like the same things or everybody be after your grandma. You know, so it's good that we that we like different stuff, you know. So, you know, you can go back to any period in our history. And you can say, well, in the 50s, we got really pretty cosmopolitan. We got pretty slick. We were strings, and we were trying to be Frank Sinatra, and everybody was a crooner. And then Buck and Merle come along and put the twang back in it, put the honky-tonk and the beer joint back in it. And that's evolved from the jug bands and the fiddlers of the earliest days. It changed to Roy Acuff, and then it changed again. It's always going to change, and I don't think it'd be very interesting if it stayed the same.
Well, I got time. Let me see what everybody else wants to know here. Straight to the inside mechanics here. For any of you guys, how difficult/expensive was it to get the music rights?
Very expensive. Typically, our music budget would be 3-4% of our total budget. In this case, it was close to 25%.
And was it, and aside from writing the checks, how difficult? I mean, did everybody want to play,
yes,
you know, to play ball here?
They did, actually. I would say by and large they did. And that was really wonderful. I mean, in many respects, whether it was doing interviews or, you know, collecting photographs, we felt very welcomed by the country music family right from the get-go, and that was really wonderful. And you know, clearing music rights is for the 584 cues is a really big job. Peter Miller here in New York helped us out a lot, and but I would say that on the whole, people were very interested and willing to play ball, and you know, happy that we were taking this on. So it was a big, big multi-year task, but it went pretty well, I think.
I mean, Ken, do you feel like this is you were able to do what you wanted to do?
Yeah, no, I mean, that's one of the things of working in public broadcasting is we get to put the director's cut out. We don't have to complain after the fact that we didn't get to do it. And I should say that for all of the tough editing that we committed on Dayton's original script, he's got a companion book that's out that is a fantastic a chance to restore some of the things that the demands of filmmaking don't permit him to do. And we also have an amazing bunch of music coming out from Sony that's for his CD set. And it ain't 574 cuts, but it's close. It's got a lot.
So question, this is for, well, two-part question for Vince, though I'm curious for others to jump in. First part, which you started to speak to, how do you see country music evolving into the future? Second part, what do you think the chances for the Nashville Predators are this season?
In a city with two New York teams, I ain't saying nothing. I love my Preds. I love hockey since I was a little kid, and we actually, believe it or not, had a minor league team in Oklahoma City. We figured out how to grow ice, and we could get a hockey team. But, they'll do great. You know, I don't worry too much about, you know, what the future of music's going to be. It's going to be in the hands of young people that are inspired to play and sing, and you can't, there's no reason to put shackles on them, you know, to say you can't do this. That's the worst thing you could ever do to somebody is try to squash their hopes and dreams and their creativity, you know. Nobody did that to me when I was a kid. Nobody ever told me what I couldn't do. You can't do that because it's not this or it's not that. You don't hear a rock and roll record and have somebody say, "Ah, that's a little too rock and roll." You know? And you don't want to have anybody say, "Hey, that's a little too country." It happens, but you know, there's no point in it. And I just, I think there's always when you do this, when you have a microphone in your hand, you're always in danger of really screwing up, you know, and saying something stupid. And there's a lot of gotcha questions out there. You know, sometimes people want to know, they want you to arf on what they don't like, you know, or something like that. And it's just, you know, I said, it's not my place to tell anybody what they should or shouldn't do. I'm just cheering them all on. I'm not a hater.
Can I say that I think if somebody does say, film on the history of country music 20 years from now that will cover this chapter that we ignore because we're in the midst of it. Two things that I feel very sure will happen. One is that right now, you know, that it'll be very clear that a lot of things are going on in country music with just tremendous young artists. And it doesn't mean that you hear them on the radio is a different thing. And to equate all of what you think the perimeters are of country music by what is on country radio is a big mistake. And so that's another thing. We don't know who those people will be because they might not yet be being heard. The second thing is that in our film, Vince Gill, already a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, is prominent because in the early going he has important things to say about the history of country music, and then as you saw, we spend time with him because of his great artistry. But what the next one will get to is just how I know this from being, you know, spending a lot of time in Nashville, how encouraging he has been in helping young artists. So he'll be viewed in an even more elevated thing, the way that we talk about certain producers and other folks, that Vince is carrying, is doing the passing down without without, you know, making it down. He's passing it along, I should have said, in just the most wonderful way. And he will be remembered for that as well.
And just to bring... just to bring that question full circle so we can close up all the way back to episode one. I mean, I feel like what's behind that and what's behind a lot of those questions, where is it going and the different influences and the different things are in there. Well, that's the rub that you're talking about from the opening minutes of the movie.
Exactly. And, you know, I suppose if we'd finished this a year later, we could have, you know, Lil Nas X in our outgoing, you know, our outro, which shows a lot of the contemporary people that we're consciously not dealing with. But let's stop for a second. As Vince has acknowledged, this open relationship with African American music, that the number one song, right? You can have an argument, if you want to have an argument, about why Billboard didn't put it on or did put it on or why they took it off. That's beside the point. The number one song, period, is by a black gay rapper. I mean, that's the mic drop on America right now. I mean, if you're so worried about it, isn't this an incredible sign of our health? That this is the number one song ever. It's a country song called Old Town Road by a black gay rapper. I mean, this is... exactly what we hoped it would be, right? I mean,
over a Nine Inch Nails sample and wearing a cowboy hat.
I mean, it's really, it transcends that bind, that when Vince says, he's absolutely right, you get a mic in front of you, get a question and you're in big trouble. There's nothing binary here about it. People have voted what they want, what they like, what they're drawn to. This is a wonderful commentary on what the present is and the future is, just as much as we can lament about the absence of women on country radio in a musical form that is stunning, surprising from the very first moment about women and how strong a role they play from Mother Maybelle, you know, to Dolly to beyond. It's an amazing story. We can complain about this and complain about that what's on country music radio doesn't sound like it, and maybe what's called Americana or roots is what this is, but it's just music, and people are responding to the good stuff. And Old Town Road is, you know, it's a phenomenon that I think we shouldn't poo-poo in any way and say yes, but, which is our tendency with anything. It's a really great moment for us to enjoy and revel in. And D. Ford Bailey is really happy to hear about this. D. Ford Bailey is one of the early black stars of the Grand Ole Opry, a diminutive harmonica player who was forced out in kind of familiar and bored, boring, discriminatory reasons, but is one of the great players and one of the great legacies that we detail in our film.
Before they kick us out of here, Vince, you want to play another song for us?
Well, watching Merle sing so many songs about his mama, I have a new record. You guys may know this, but the title of my new record was inspired by this documentary. My new record is called Okie, and because I watched Merle and I watched the truth be told about the history of the word and all of that. And so this is a song that's been around for a long, long time. The first song I ever wrote as a young kid was about my mom, and it was pretty bad. But, you know, all that stuff you're saying is so true and so right. The first lead guitar player in the history of country music was a woman. And for some reason, the guys get all the credit, but not to me. Mother Maybelle was the first, so she's kind of the most important. And so is my mom. My mom was born in the fall of 1925, at the same time the Opry started. And anyway, I finally thought it was appropriate to sing a song for her. called A Letter to My Mama. Oh, I need to write a letter, put it down in black and white. A phone call just won't cut it, not the way I feel tonight. A letter to my mama from the bottom of my heart. I'm sorry, it's a real good place to start. I'm sorry I was selfish, just chalk it up to youth. I got too old to need you, that's just running from the truth. I'm sorry things didn't work out for you and my old man. Sometimes life don't turn out like you planned. Looking back, I wonder how you ever pulled us through. I can't imagine walking in your shoes. If I could stop this pen from shaking, I'd write these words down too. There's no one in this world I love like you. Oh, I've written down the memories of these 60-some-odd years, trying hard to just say thank you as I wipe away the tears. I hear my grandson calling, so I guess I better go. I can never pay you back the love I owe. Oh, I finished up the letter, put it down in black and white. No, a phone call wouldn't cut it, not the way I feel tonight. A letter to my mama from the bottom of my heart. Very bottom of my heart.
Thank you much. Vince Gill, Ken Burns, Julie Dunfey. Dayton Duncan, country music premieres Sunday night, the 15th on PBS. Thank you all.